Welcome to the only place where real, raw, and vulnerable conversations happen with IFBB Bikini Pros to give you an inside look at their struggles, strategies, mindset, passions, and all of life beyond the stage. This podcast is made to inspire, motivate, and remind competitors and the average gym goer that even the most extreme lifestyles and elite athletes have their ups and downs. Thank you so much for tuning in today. I'm your host, Celeste Rains Turk, and now it's time for the Confessions of a Bikini Pro podcast. Today, we are speaking with an athlete who has personally inspired me ever since I knew what competing even was. She is a mom of two who started competing in 2011, made her pro debut in 2013, and has even graced the Olympia stage. This athlete last competed in 2018. She works as a one-on-one trainer and posing coach to local clients in Oregon and serves as an online coach to a select few. Welcome to the show, Francesca Lauren. How are you?
I am doing amazing. Thank you, Celeste.
Of course. I'm so happy to have you. Like I said, you really have inspired me since the get-go. And there's, for people who've been in the sport for so long, it's like, oh my gosh, we could talk about so many things. So I've got lots planned. but I love to.
Yes, we can.
Yes. And anything you want to share, like I said, please do. But I always love to start off by asking if there's a ritual you have or anything that you think about or do right before your heel hits the stage.
I actually do. I think I kind of developed this ritual after working with one of my coaches, and it was just breathing. So I do this weird thing where I'll like throw my head back, open up my lungs, take like a huge deep breath through my nose, big exhale through the mouth, and just try to catch my breath or control my breath, if that makes sense. Because I know when I get really anxious and my anxiety is just through the roof right before I hit stage. I don't know about you, but I just need to feel like in control of that breath. And then I just repeat to myself that, you know, you are blessed, you are loved, own this moment, and then sashay onto that stage. So that is my ritual.
Awesome. I love that. I like how you have your little affirmation too, right after breathing. That's awesome.
Yeah. I mean, it's kind of just been like what's helped me. I need like a rhythm, I suppose, or like structure to feel confident about, you know, everything that I've done leading up to it.
Well, it's funny you say that because last night me and my boyfriend, we were watching UFC fight with Rose. And I guess in the corner before she started fighting, she would say to herself, I am the best. And she would just repeat that until they basically started the fight. And I thought that was so interesting. And she won. And at the end, she's like, I am the best. And I thought, you know, that's like what competitors who have come on the show will sometimes say, or like you're saying, it's a boost of confidence. It not only calms you down, but it gives you that boost you need before stepping onto, like you said, sashay up there and show your best.
Yeah. I mean, honestly, a lot of just in sports in general, it's a lot about mindset. I mean, you just really have to have the confidence within yourself. I mean, going and watching like a basketball game, kind of what you were saying, you were watching, you know, the UFC fight. There's times where I'm at a basketball game and I could just literally be watching the players, you know, movement, like how they are setting up to, you know, shoot the basket or whatever it is that they're doing. Like I can kind of call when the basket's going to make it and when it's not. And it's almost their body language on how they're about to position to hit that shot. And I'm like, oh, it's not going to go. Oh, it didn't, you know? And
yeah,
it's almost the same thing when you're going on stage. It's your mindset. You have to be all in and just go for it and have that confidence in yourself, because it actually does show when you're not, believe it or not.
Absolutely. No, it really does. I always know, like if I go to a show and, or if I'm at a show and I'm watching girls going on there, you can tell who's feeling really good and who's not. And you personally have had such an amazing journey over the years, being in this industry for over a decade and this sport, and you've grown, you've contributed, you've evolved so much. And I was hoping you could take us through this journey as best you can, from why you started and your path to turning pro, and then your experiences since then.
Oh, absolutely. So I started competing very much on a whim. I had a girlfriend who worked with me at my, you know, full-time career job. And she was like, I'm going to do bodybuilding, cute little blonde cheerleader type. And I looked at her like, what? You're going to do bodybuilding? I mean, all I knew about bodybuilding back then was literally, you know, the men's
right.
bodybuilders and maybe some figure girls, but you didn't really see that, you know, in mainstream anything mm-hmm. much. So I kind of thought, oh, okay, wow. She's like, no, there's this new division. It's called bikini. Oh, you would love it. It's so much fun. Like, you should do it. And I was interested, but I wasn't like all on board. So mm-hmm. I kind of watched her through this journey. And mind you, I had my kids. Like, I've had my two kids, and I wasn't in like not good shape, but I wasn't like, I look at a magazine and I want to look like that shape. Mm-hmm. So I just watched her through this journey, and she would share little bits like, oh, you should be eating breakfast. Like, you need to be eating, you know, taught me about like timing. You know, she was like, oh, you know, I have to eat every so many hours. And I thought, why not give it a shot? You know, the hardest thing to learn how to do was learn to eat breakfast. I'll tell you that much.
Really?
Yes. Oh my God. Celeste, when I look back at before I even learned anything about anything, I could not believe how horrible my so-called healthy eating habits were. I mean, I thought I was healthy, and wow, I was so very, very wrong. So I had to learn to eat breakfast on a regular basis. And at first, you know, like eating a half a cup of oatmeal was torture because it was just so much oatmeal. Mm-hmm. Now a half a cup is not even enough.
I know. I'm but, like, oh, to have half a cup when you're in deep right? debt as a prep too.
Oh man. So I just learned all those little nuances. Like, I didn't know how to read a label back then. So just learning how to read a label, didn't know what I was reading, didn't know anything about macros yet, but just slowly learning all these different things. And then she was telling me she's about to do a show, and I had actually lost a lot of weight, and I was just one little lean bean. I was so proud of myself to get down that far. And she's like, you should try and do the show with me. And, you know, at the time, my husband, my ex-husband, he wasn't really loving the idea, but was like, all right, if that's what you want to do. So 2 weeks before the show, I decided to jump in. I thought, this is the greatest I've ever lived in my life. I'm just going to go for it. And it was very, thinking back to it, it was very impromptu. I don't think I would ever do that again, nor would I recommend anyone do that. But, you know, I was just very curious, and I can be impulsive. So I did the show. It was, I mean, I thought I deserved better, but now that I know about the sport and really what judges are looking at, and obviously I've gone through a lot of experiences to understand, like, definitely, I definitely didn't deserve what I thought I had deserved maybe back then, because I knew nothing. So I realized I knew nothing at least, and decided to join a team the following year. It was like at the end of 2011. So I decided to join a team. I think more just for the moral support. I did my own training. I did my own nutrition because I could not afford a coach for anything. Yeah. The team was really more for the posing practice aspect and the community aspect. And it was, you know, a really great experience. And, I learned a lot from, you know, various competitors that I would just meet, through the coaches that were, you know, part of that team. And I just kind of, they just were like, you should do this show, all local shows. And so I started, you know, off at one, and then I got first place, and then I did another, and I got first place, and every show I did, I kept getting first place. And I just remember attending seminars, and, you know, it was a Tangie Johnson seminar, and she was saying, you know, hey, you know, just because you win a show doesn't mean you should go straight to nationals. You know, it's a local show. Sometimes you really have to like take a look at what is going to nationals and realize what you're going to be up against versus where you are now. And so I was just like, oh, okay, like living the dream, just loving doing shows. I just got super sucked in. And they were like, you should go to nationals. Well, wait, you guys just said, take some time. don't go. So I was all in, let's go. Let's do nationals. And I was the USA's in 2012. And I was added to the first call outs. Mm-hmm. And I didn't really know what that meant because I was still very new to it. And they added me. I got moved around. I think I got mine and moved to the middles. And you know, the people that were there with me were like, oh my gosh, you're totally top five. Da, da, da. I'm like, I don't know. I just wanted to be like in the 15 or in the first 10 or something like that. So I was super excited about it. I got my hopes up like really high. And then I didn't make top five. And I was just crushed. Mm-hmm. I was so sad. I cried backstage for so long. And I finally mustered up, you know, enough courage to wipe off all my makeup, because all that makeup that we have on our face just comes streaming down. Wipe off all my makeup and, you know, try and scoot out without anyone seeing me. And, you know, after that, I was like, you know what? Who saw? I don't know why I got so upset with myself. I shouldn't have got my hopes up. I really just wanted to break top 15, top 10. And I did. What am I so upset about? So I let it go. Got sucked into doing another one. It was the bodybuilding championships. And I think it's in, I think they do it in Miami all the time now, but it used to be Atlanta and Miami. They would go back and forth every year. So when I did it, it was in Atlanta. And they're like, just one more. You're already ready. Come on. You might as well. Oh, fine. I guess I could use the experience regardless. It was a learning lesson the first time. This will be another learning lesson. So I went there and I walked away with my pro card. I expected absolutely nothing. I really expected absolutely nothing. And I ended up walking away with my pro card at that show. So I really literally flew through my whole amateur career of bodybuilding. It was just one show after another. And then after getting my pro card, I was like, okay, one show after another. And I literally don't think I stopped really until 2018. Like I haven't taken a break longer than 6 months, 4 months, maybe since 2018. So this is the longest break I have ever taken.
Yes, I noticed that because you had been competing year after year after year after year, literally. Mm-hmm. And yes. I think there was, like you said, those short breaks, maybe around like holiday time. And that was really the end of the season. And then you were just hopping back in. So I was actually curious, like, why now? How did you decide that now is the time to hang up the heels for a bit?
A couple of things. I would say the first was a shift in priorities. I recently got married in 2018 to my husband, Neil, and he's been the biggest supporter. He, you know, has literally pushed me to keep going in times where I was like, I don't even know, maybe I should just, you know, toss in the heels and be done with it. And he's like, what are you talking about? You're just upset right now. I know your talks. I'm sure I'm not the only one that goes through it when, you know, things don't go in our favor and we're a little upset. It never really sticks. We always are like, okay, suck it up, cupcake, true, let's that. Go. after we got married, we've talked about expanding our family and having children. So that was the deal. So I'm taking a big break with that. It's been excruciatingly difficult to not compete and to not be in prep because, you know, where I'm at with my day-to-day now, at first it was heaven when I took the break. I went straight to a honeymoon, literally. So we were just all you could eat buffet, you know, in Bora Bora, just loving it. And then coming home to literally Thanksgiving, more food. And then you got, you know, New Year's and Christmas and it was, yeah. So that was not ideal situation for me, but it was a much needed break. And I think my body was just so happy that I finally gave myself that break. And then, you know, I actually decided not to train for quite a while. I just didn't really, I think I had burnt myself out. My issue was I weighed myself and measured myself for my wedding dress when I was in show prep. Mm-hmm. So when I had to get married, which was in November, I was planning on Olympia for that year. It didn't happen. So, but I had to stay in shape for my wedding dress.
Right.
I measured myself in show shape for my wedding dress. So I was like, well, not a horrible thing, but man, that diet, just the continuous, you know, on prep, so to speak, when I kind of didn't really need to have to be, was rough for me. And I think my body was like, yo, it's break time. We need to recover and just relax and no more training and just repair. And I did. And now I got to a point where I started missing the gym again and missing my workouts and missing, you know, just being in that routine. Cause it was nice to have no routine, but I actually did love it. I think I just got out of balance with the over the top with the routine. So it's kind of now I'm coming back to that point of finding that balance, but also being mindful that, you know, we're trying to have a little one, so I can't be too crazy.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, that's, first of all, your story is just so relatable, I think, especially for aspiring competitors who know nothing about bodybuilding, know nothing about bikini, maybe, or even just listening to this podcast, like, yeah, I don't know how to read a label, you know, and they're where you once were. And then there's the relatability to people who go on a streak of shows. I mean, I've been there 2017, 2018. I was like, I'm going to keep going. And it's like, this is not, there comes a point where it's not productive. And then,
And then
there's the girls who have stepped on a national stage and they've not gotten the result they wanted. And then they went on and they are in their pro card, or that's what their goal is. So your journey as a competitor is very inspiring. And beyond that, you know, you've had this experience post your last show of prioritizing other aspects of your life and this new journey that you and your husband want to go on together. So how has this maybe impacted the way that you view yourself? Because I imagine, you know, in the industry, sometimes there's a lot of pressure, I think, to maintain a certain look or a certain activity level when you are competing back to back. Like, how has this influenced the way you see yourself, or maybe the way you think others see you?
Oh, gosh. I actually just kind of did a post similar to that. It is hard. There is a lot of pressure, I personally feel, and this is just me and how I feel about things, because I am sensitive to, I'm a people pleaser. I like to try and help people. And that, I think, is like my biggest issue, is sometimes I just like will offer free advice and just constantly try and help people and really not expect anything in return. Cause I just think that's, you know, what good people do. And I like to be that for other people. And then when I feel like I can't be what I preach about, it just gets, I don't know, it's like a fuzzy line for me. I feel unconfident, and I feel that it's important to practice what you preach. But then I also come to that point where it's kind of like, you know, other people go through this stuff too. And I can't be so hard on myself. What I see myself in, or how I see myself, may not be how other people see me. And, you know, I can't even tell you how many workout videos I've recorded and how many pictures I've taken. And I just am like, nope, I'm not posting it. I don't feel comfortable about it. I don't feel good about this. And it's, I know it's all in my head and just how I feel about it. But it is hard because you feel like you're going to get critiqued, especially when people see you. And especially, I guess for me, I mean, I have been just kind of in between, like, I might have gotten like, you know, fluffy in between shows when I might have had like a 4 or 6 month break, but I was never like really that much heavier than from stage weight. I might have gained like 10, 15 pounds, but nothing really too much more. And so to be a little heavier than that now, it's really uncomfortable. And you feel like people are going to look at you and snicker and be like, oh my God, look at her now. Look, oh my gosh, she blew up. Ooh. Mm-hmm. it is normal to gain weight, especially, you know, if you've got muscle on your body, it's just going to look a little different. You're not going to look like someone who has more body fat and zero muscle. So it's kind of that I feel like I need to look a certain way, and I feel like people are going to snicker and comment, and I know that's not healthy mentally. I mean, I really shouldn't care what other people think, but I can't help it. I am human, and I do worry about it, and I don't like how I feel about my body right now. So that's why I think people just don't like to post when they're in off season a lot. I think a lot of people see, you know, there was someone who commented, oh, you know, I post old photos, or all the photos I post now are just all my old photos. And I'm like, yeah, I've been there. But, you know, sometimes I might throw up a flashback Friday or a throwback Thursday or a way back Wednesday or whatever. How many can you come up with? But I haven't really even been super active, because I just don't even want to post that and act like that's where I'm at, because it's not. I want people to know that, you know, hey, if you see me, I don't want it to be like, oh, you looked totally not like yourself from the photo I just saw you post. Like, I want to be a real person. And that's important to me to send that message, to send the message that I am a real person and I have feelings. And that's kind of why I decided, you know what, I think other people need to see this and hear this, because when I was having a hard time, I would see all of the other competitors who are, you know, obviously active on the circuit now. And I, you know, have competed and I've gotten to know a lot of these girls, and they're all amazing, beautiful girls inside and out. And that's one of the things I miss about competing so much, and seeing them doing so well, and just like how much they've grown and how they've changed and what they've developed. And it's just awesome to see that. And it's motivating. And at the same time, it's like, I'm not there. Mm-hmm. I wish I was there. I wish I could focus on that. And the problem with that is, as I'm focusing on what I don't have, and it's just reframing that mindset and reminding yourself what I do have. So, and I don't see much of that, I guess. I don't really see much people posting about that. You know, here's where I'm at. Here's what I'm blessed for having. And, you know, things will come when the time is meant to be. Mm-hmm. And it just was important to, I guess, kind of put it out there, because I think I saw a couple. I mean, I have seen a couple. It's not as popular, I guess. Maybe it's just my feed. I don't know all the algorithms and whatnot of social media, what they are anymore anyways. But I do know that when people do look up to you, as much as they want to see all the good positive things, I think it's important to also see the negatives as well, or not the negatives, but more of the trials and, you know, challenges that they come across, that and how they deal with it too, and that they're not always on this super high of life and everything is, you know, painted rose. I probably just ramble, but I love the ramble.
Oh my gosh. Okay. No, I love that. I was just taking it all in. Like, wow, so much vulnerability. And I appreciate that from you and for coming in here and sharing all of this, because I know personally, like, I've been there. You know, I work with a lot of girls who go through this. It's a real part of the industry. It's a real part of competing. It happens to everybody. And I think that what you just said about having gratitude for where you're at is interesting, because most of us as competitors, we're always striving for what can be better, what can be next, how can we evolve? Mm-hmm. You know, what's going to take us to the next level? But when we step back and, you know, we say, well, this time off is going to allow me to X, Y, Z, you know, build a family, heal a relationship with food, or spend more time with friends, expand my education, whatever it might be. It's important to celebrate that too, even if our body changes. Our body's always going to change, right? Like, literally always going to change. And we develop this, like, we develop this image in our head of what a competitor should look like, or what we've looked like as competitors. And I think that's then, you know, promoted and perpetuated in the industry when people don't share how they look outside of a competition prep. So I think it's great that you have shared that.
Yeah. I mean, it's like off season. What do people look like off season? And I mean, I don't want to like try and make it sound like a shame for not sharing, because if I didn't share, I didn't feel comfortable. I didn't want to share. I just didn't feel comfortable. I didn't feel good about it. Inside, a huge, like, you don't feel good about it, don't do it. But if you are in a point where you can feel comfortable, like, I know some people take, you know, before and after pictures. They don't want to share their before when they are in the before. They're like, no, I'm going to wait till I'm at that after. And that's totally fine. I mean, I'm not saying that it's good. It's just, it's hard. I think it's hard for people to share when they are not at their best and they know that they could be better. And it's such a focus on the aesthetic, and there's no focus on, you know, like what you just said, other things in life. Now's the time to, you know, learn something new or focus on, you know, other priorities in life, period. So it's huge.
Yes. And it doesn't mean you're no longer a competitor. It's like, okay, let's expand our definition of being a competitor. What does that look like in all phases, in all seasons? And why is it okay that yours can look different? You know, allow that to be okay. And I like how you said, you know, you may not be comfortable sharing yet, and one day you will be. And I think this makes me think of, you know, if someone's going through a rough time, emotionally or mentally, they may not come straight out and say, like, I'm depressed, and use social media to cure their depression, right? Instead, they take the time to process it and work through it. And then they might open up and share. And that's because we also need space to process it. So I think, like you said, if someone's going through that, maybe they want to share, process it first, you know, like, really consider, what does it mean to be a competitor? Can I be a competitor even without maybe, quote unquote, looking like one or doing what everybody else is doing in the industry? And I think that's a valuable conversation to have with yourself, and to know that you can change what's normal in the industry.
Absolutely. I mean, getting comfortable with being uncomfortable. And I know I've posted about this before when I was in great shape, you know, but it's hard to get comfortable with being uncomfortable. I think a lot of people worry too much. And so, you know, just kind of embracing the fact that things will change, and the definition of what a competitor should be year round. I mean, bringing light to it, I think, is great. I love seeing other people sharing, and when other people comment and say, hey, I was in this about a year ago, or I was experiencing this, or this is what I'm going through now. I mean, you know, I have to thank everyone who does share that kind of information, because it's not easy to say. There was like I don't know if it was a meme or a quote or something, but, you know, not everyone who's smiling is, you know, in the greatest place. You know, you have no idea what's going on behind someone's life, you know, behind that smile. They could be going through, I'll tell you, I went through I went through a divorce when I, you know, got my pro card. I was going through custody battles during, you know, the last 3 years of my shows. There's just been so many things in the background of my life when I like may have looked like I was at the height of my career in the IFBB. Like there was a lot that I was dealing with. I don't know. I'm looking back now. I'm like, how did I juggle that? Like, let alone obviously, you know, raising my kids and making them a priority and trying to keep the family a priority. And I probably looked like the happiest person. And oh my gosh, my life is just so amazing. And nobody knew. Like, I didn't want to share that information. I didn't want everyone to know what I was going through. You know, everyone has their own battles that we don't know that they're fighting. And I think it's really important for people to understand when they should really bring competing or look to compete. Like, is it something that you can feasibly do in your life at that point in time? Like right now, I would love to, but is this a feasible thing? No, it's not, because the priority is elsewhere right now. And I just physically cannot do both. So it's kind of a hard thing to see and I guess physically go through, but it's definitely a good way to look at it, that the stage isn't going anywhere. And I know Sandy says this in her seminars. If anyone's attended Sandy's seminars, you know, the stage isn't going to go anywhere. It's going to be there in 2 years. It's going to be there in 3 years. And if there's a will, there's a way. So if now is not the time, and I see a lot of fresh competitors coming right off, you know, earning their pro card and then going straight into, I guess this could be a piece of advice that I would throw in there, but going straight into the IFBB and doing their show, which is great. I mean, if you just earned your pro card, you're dying to get on stage, right? You're like, I'm pro. I want to go there. I got to go compete with the pros. And I would encourage that. I think it'd be a great experience, but I also think that it's important to take a look at the caliber of the athlete that you are now competing against. You are now, you know, a small fish in a big pond. You're no longer the big fish in the small pond. So you really have to take a look at what you're up against. And, you know, I do find that, you know, amateur athletes, that's a good starting point. Like they saw potential in you, that you can take this and bring it to the next level. And that might not be that you're at the next level. I mean, you definitely want to work with coaches or with someone who can give you realistic advice and say, hey, no, you're there, or hey, no, this is what we need to do now to work on to bring you to that level before they just dive right in. Because my first 4 years as an amateur, I was self-coached and I just went show to show to show. And I probably would have gone a lot further, a lot faster if I had some guidance at the beginning of my pro career.
Absolutely. So that's something you would have done differently then.
Yeah, definitely. Probably would have looked for someone to work with a little sooner rather than later. And, you know, that you just don't know what you don't know. There were things, I mean, I was just living the dream and doing show after show. I don't get me wrong. I loved it. It was just the greatest experience. And I went through the school of hard knocks. I'll just call it that. It mm-hmm. was a learning experience every show, from the stage look to the posing, to the physique, to, you know, how to pack for a show. Oh my gosh. I like came up with systems and processes for, I have a checklist for my packing. I've learned that, oh no, this is my show bag. So I have my little carry-on bag that has all of my show stuff,
yes.
My heels, my suit, my makeup, my hair, my everything. So if I show up and for some reason my other bag gets lost, I can still go on stage. I'm good. So, I mean, mm-hmm. I, I definitely learned a lot going from show to show, but I think it would have been wiser and more efficient use of time to find someone to work with when I got started back then. So, yeah,
you know, really like that advice.
Yeah, live and learn.
Yeah, absolutely. Like finding someone to guide you through the process, and also knowing that the eagerness that you have doesn't always equate to the readiness that other people may have, that, hey, yeah, you have the potential, or yeah, you got the reward, but let's take a step back and reevaluate. And that's where maybe more eyes can be helpful. And I think, you know, competing so many times back to back and year after year can be really taxing on your body. And then mm-hmm. when you come close so many times to a first place, or you're enjoying it and getting so much positive feedback and reinforcement, it can be easy to get sucked in. Did you ever feel like you got sucked into maybe chasing a placing or just the sport in general?
At the beginning, when I was going through that whole 4 years of self-coaching, it was just literally like just trying to do a little bit better each time. I mean, I obviously didn't just hit top five right out of the gate. You know, it took some time. And I do remember my first show, I finally got second place. Oh my gosh. I felt great. And I was like, okay, if I could just get top five again, like that's kind of my mentality, was mm-hmm. just to do a little bit better or just remain consistent in the placings. Like, cause what I really wanted to do with, you know, competing, like my personal goal, well, obviously Olympia was like, I want to be in the Olympia. Oh my gosh. Big dream would be to place top five at the Olympia. But just to qualify for the Olympia was like my first baby step, I guess, towards that. Mm-hmm. And it was just a slow progression. Like I have a big goal, and then I have all the little goals that are supposed to help me maneuver my way towards that big goal. So then it's more realistic, even no matter how big your goal is. So it went from just maybe getting top five to consistently getting a top five to trying to get a first place. And I think my last 2 years, I was like chasing that first place. Yeah. And I think 2018 was the year that it was all point qualified. And I missed the Olympia by 1 point. And that was like, you know, a huge upset for me personally. But I mean, after that, I was like, okay, this idea of chasing is kind of sucking the fun out of it for me. And that was, I guess I would say that would be another reason why it was time to take that break. I mean, I needed to take a step back. If I get so sucked in that I am just, you know, like beating myself up, even though I've done so well, then it might be a time to take a step back. It shouldn't feel like a chore. This is, you know, this is just a passion project. Yeah. Like it's my passion project. I love doing this so much that I would like, I don't care if I don't make money at it. I just want to do something and be good at it. That was my mentality. But when it gets sucked out of the fun and just doing it, then I think it was really important to take that step back and kind of realize we can't chase things anymore. When you chase things, you know, you're focusing again on what you don't have, a negative thing. It's something that you're lacking. And I had so much to be grateful for, and I've accomplished so much. And rather than coming from a place of appreciation, and it's really easy to get wrapped up in that. It's really hard to not realize that that's not important. Enjoying what you're doing is important. The fact that I could do what I was doing for so long is, you know, a blessing unto itself. So it was probably the best thing for me to just take that huge step back. And now seeing it from, like, you know, looking back at it now, it was okay. Yep. I was kind of crazy. I think mm-hmm. I did like, you know, 6 to 9 shows, you know, a year, every year. So yeah. I really was kind of like, I mean, I did live it very much as a lifestyle. So don't get me wrong. I wasn't like torturing myself. Okay. I was very much, this is my lifestyle. You know, I enjoy doing this. But that first 4 years when I was kind of doing everything on my own before I was intuitively eating. I was doing macros, and it was kind of a mix between if it's your macros, eating clean, nutritional timing, kind of situation. Like, that's really, I wanted it to be a part of my life. I would be fairly not as super strict, you know, in between shows or in off seasons. I would have like, you know, my date nights, and I would get my, you know, little meal treats. And then when it came down to showtime, I would slowly cut things out, and it would take me about anywhere from 4 to 2 weeks to get ready for a show. But as I got more and more like aggressive with pushing to try and achieve a first place, that's when I really started. And it is when I started working with coaches. My diet really started becoming very, because if I'm going to work with someone, I'm going to do what they tell me to do. Yeah. I will follow it to the T. I will not deviate. If you say 1 teaspoon of peanut butter, I will measure 1 teaspoon mm-hmm. of peanut butter, and I will eat 1 teaspoon of peanut butter. I mean, to me, I was, as I measured it, believe it or not, I'm like, this is like nothing. Like, why right. am I even eating this? Does this even provide anything?
I know. Seriously.
You know, like, maybe it's a mental thing. I don't know. But no, I get very focused, and I am like a personality when it comes to certain things like that. It has to all be measured, and it has to be perfect, and it has to be on time. And, you know, I think that might've been an issue. It might've gone a little overboard. Yeah.
It can become that way for sure. But I'm curious, you know, now you're not competing, you've been taking this time off. You took time off of the gym as well. You're doing it now because you really felt the call to come back to it. How does your lifestyle look now? Is it more like the intuitive version of you, or is it a mix of both, or is it neither?
So I would say it's a tiny bit mix of both. I'm trying to be more intuitive, to be completely fair. Mm-hmm. I definitely think it's important to listen to your body and to understand the difference between something like hunger and thirst signals. You know, are you really hungry, or are you just thirsty? Like, did I drink my water? Nope, I'm really behind on the water. Got to start drinking my water. Making healthier decisions. Because when I wasn't really worrying about food, I still tracked everything. I might not have always looked at what I was eating, but I tracked everything. So I still felt like at least I have an idea of what I was doing, where I was going. And then there, I would go in little like spurts of like, okay, I need to like pull it back in here, Francesca, because I would get uncomfortable and I would start trying to dial a diet back in, and I would kind of feel comfortable. And then I would allow myself to just eat whatever. So right now I am doing a little bit of the tracking. I am tracking, but I am also just trying to, I'm still doing like, 4 or 5 meals a day. So I'll have my breakfast, I'll have my lunch, I'll have my pre-workout snack, post-workout snack, and then I'll have a dinner. Sometimes I won't have the pre-workout snack. It just depends on the day and timing and whatnot. I kind of have an idea of what foods weigh now just by sight. Like, so I don't always measure things. I can kind of eyeball it now because I've done it for so long. Mm-hmm. So like I do that. I haven't started prepping my meals yet. And I know that's a huge part for me to, if I really want to start like really getting back into it. But am I willing to sacrifice my time to do that right now? Haven't committed to that yet. And this is just what goes through my head. Yeah. When I am about to make a change in my life. I weigh the sacrifice and what I want to have accomplished and decide, is this something that is important to me right now? What, like, I kind of go through this process of like, okay, these are the changes I want to have. What do I need to do? What am I not doing? Am I willing to start take this step to make this happen? And I get this a lot with my clients that I work with. There's definitely, you know, a whole process of change, and you have to realize where you're at on that like scale of change, like yes. pre-contemplation, contemplation, getting ready for it. Okay, let's do it. Now I'm all in. Now we got to maintain. So there's, you know, I do those checks with myself, because reality, I know myself so well. I know when I'm really ready, and I know when I'm kind of like, you know, I need to baby step my way into this. Let's dip the toes in the pool real quick and just, okay, now we're ready. And just finding like what works for me with that point in time. So the whole meal prep thing, it would take me a day to prep all my foods, which would be like a day that I spend time with my family. I mean, I do actually have a full-time job outside of training and coaching other people. So I work 8-hour days. And when I go and coach or train people after work, in addition to work, you know, I'm taking time away from my family, and then to spend another day, well, in addition to my own personal training, because I've just recently started getting on top of a more consistent training regime for myself. So to start meal prepping again, that would take another day away from my family and time with my kids and my husband. And that's important to them. I'm not willing, unless they want to prep food with me. And I mean, I could try to make it a party. I mean, we could blow streamers or something. I don't know, but I don't think they would really enjoy doing that. So if my husband were to maybe like have plans and my kids were going to be outside playing, then yeah, I'll take advantage of it. But if that's not going to happen, then it's just not a priority right now. So I can't really worry or fuss about it. I'll have to make other means work around it. So I guess that's kind of just where I'm at right now. I definitely know that it's important that I personally need to make those changes. And so I pick and choose what sacrifices I can make that will work with everyone in my household.
I think it's admirable that you take the time to consider other people who are involved in this journey as well. I also think it's interesting, and I appreciate, you know, you took us through that behavior change model and how you've applied it to your life and your clients' lives. And I think something that you've posted about before that stood out to me is things like meditating or sitting with yourself, showing up for yourself, making time mm-hmm. for yourself, and really focusing on those priorities in your life, which for you, one of the top ones is your family, and you're already giving mm-hmm. so much of your time and energy elsewhere. What does a normal day look like for you? Because you are, you know, working and being a mom and a wife and a trainer.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So my kids are at home school right now. They're doing like a hybrid thing, but they uh-huh. are, you know, we haven't sent them physically back to school yet because they just started that. And we were like, let's see how it goes first.
Yeah.
You know? And so they're home school with the computers and doing school from the computers. I actually work from home with the job that I do. So I'm actually home with them to keep an eye on them. Cause let's nice. Be fair, kids in the computer is on track. So, so it's a juggle between monitoring them, more my youngest, and working. And then, so after work, I start at 6:30. I finish work at about 3. After that, I, you know, slowly get ready for the gym, probably, you know, get my pre-workout meal in, go straight to the gym, get a workout in. I think my first client is typically about 5. So I'll make sure I get my workout in right before my first client. Depends on what time I get to the gym. So I decide what I'm going to do. And since I'm really just trying to focus on rebuilding some muscle, lost muscle right now, I'll always stick with, you know, a warm up and then my weights. And then if I really have no time, then I'll do cardio. If I have time, I'll do weights and cardio. So it training's kind of, as long as I'm there and I'm doing it, I have my splits kind of, I'm pretty good about figuring out my training on the fly. So I'm not really concerned about that piece of it. Then I work with my clients. Sometimes I only have one, sometimes I have two. And then I go home. If dinner's not made, usually my husband will help with dinner, but if dinner's not made, I'll make dinner, relax on the couch for a little bit. Then the kids go to get ready for bed, go to bed. Me and my husband have our time. And then the day starts all over again after we go to sleep.
That's awesome. I appreciate you walking us through that and sharing it, because there's probably a lot of moms listening who wonder how other moms get it done. And you're a working athlete as well. You're a working mom. You're working multiple jobs, actually, which is really cool. So I think it's good for other people to hear how you're managing that. Kind of branching off of that, you know, I think people struggle with finding ways to enhance their relationship or date along the way of competing. And you mentioned, you know, you got married in 2018, so a few years ago. How did you grow that relationship, or maybe prioritize growing that relationship while you were competing and after having gone through the divorce and the custody battles and being a mom? Like, how did you manage to do that?
Let me tell you, it is not easy. oh my goodness. Okay. So first and foremost, competing is a very selfish sport. I'm just going to say it because it is. It's very selfish. You have to prioritize your time, and usually you're going to be prioritizing yourself. And unfortunately, that is just kind of what you have to do, because if you're getting ready for a show and you're bringing your best, you have to make sure that you are accountable for everything that you need to do to bring your best for that show. Like, every show I go into, my intent is to win. May or may not happen, but I'm going to do everything I need to do to kind of try to make that happen. And it is really easy to forget about, you know, the needs of other people in your life. And I'm not going to lie, it was difficult for my husband and I when we were dating. And bless him, he has been like the most supportive person. Like, he will help however he can with the kids. You know, he will, you know, be my cheerleader when I'm not feeling the greatest about things. And he genuinely understood what it took for me to compete at the level that I was competing at. Like, he understood it. He didn't always like it, which is why, you know, I'm taking the break now, because we need our time to do what we are trying to accomplish together. And he's like, once that happens, I know you're going back. I'm 100% behind you. I know you can't stay away. So I know this is just part of how he envisions it. But it really takes a person to be willing to support you through all of the times that they are not going to have you at your best. So you're going to be literally spending majority of your time at the gym. When I was competing, I actually was not working. I actually didn't have a job at that point in time. And that was a huge blessing, because I was super duper focused, and to not have to worry about working and to have the support from my family when I was prepping for shows was huge. Because the first couple of years I was working, I was full-time mom, full-time single mom, you know, and I was competing and working, and I remember being just exhausted. Like, the weeks I would have my kids, I was just like up ridiculous hours prepping my food, packing their lunches, you know, planning my day, getting ready for work the next day, figuring out when I was going to get my training in. And it was insane. I don't know if I would have been able to do it as long as I was doing it if I was still like that. And so having someone who's willing to support you and help you and understand your hangriness and your need to be selfish, like, you know, stare at yourself in the mirror while you practice your posing and, you know, take the time to prep food for yourself, because let's be fair. I mean, as much as I try to give my kids, you know, like somewhat clean, healthy meals, they don't want to eat sweet potatoes or tilapia or chicken or egg whites. They want to eat normal stuff, and I'm not going to make them eat that. So it means I take extra time to prep my food. There were some instances where I had, you know, meal prep companies that sponsored me. And so those were great. Those were lifesavers when I did have them. But it wasn't like all the time. So it's definitely taxing on your family. I just, like, even my kids now, they're like, oh, mom's dieting. Like, they know when I'm in a prep. They know when I'm trying to get things. Oh, mom's dieting again. Cause they know I will not deviate. And it's nice because they now see me, you know, way more relaxed. And so now when we go out to eat, there's no like, well, they don't have options on that menu that mom can eat at, so we're not going to go there kind of thing. Now we can just go wherever. And my kids love seeing that I am being normal. But then they also know when it's time, when it's go time, what that looks like. I think it's kind of nice that they're able to actually learn about that as well. But it's, I mean, I know some people date people who are competitors as well. And sometimes someone who's in the industry, because they obviously have to know what needs to be done to get the result you want. And, you know, that I'm sure is helpful. I don't know how people compete together at the same time. I mean, I just know I get kind of moody, so I don't know about the other person, but I really do think it just comes down to finding someone who can kind of understand the lifestyle. And my husband actually like adopted it. Like, he loved going to the shows. He would talk to, you know, people there about it. He was the one who was always pushing me to be like, you need to go talk to the judges, go talk to the judges, go stand, go wait. That's awesome. Come on, I'll wait for you. And you know, if everybody's waiting in line to talk to the judges, it's a long line sometimes. And so when you're exhausted from standing on stage and your nerves being all rattled for so long, waiting in line to talk to someone, and all you want to do is just go get your meal, your little cheat meal. It's hard. So.
Oh, yes. And if you have someone waiting, you kind of sometimes feel bad or like, oh, should I? And yeah, it's nice that he's so supportive. And I appreciate that all the things that you shared are helpful. You know, it's going to require a level of acceptance, I think, from another person if you're going to be competing at the same time as trying to find someone. And I love how, you know, that worked out for you really well and positively. And you know, we've covered a lot of different topics, and I was wondering if there's anything I didn't ask you about that I should have asked you about.
Not that I can think of. I mean, gosh, I love watching everybody who is, you know, prepping for shows or are competing at shows. I mean, I miss the sport and I miss everyone. And, you know, I definitely am here cheering for everyone. So I don't want anyone to think that that's not what I'm trying to communicate here. Like, I just miss it. I'm a little jealous. And it's been really amazing watching everyone evolve. It's and the sport in general, and where things are changing and how things are changing in all different divisions and classes. So, you know, that's all my two cents. I don't really think there's anything else that's missing, unless you can think of a random.
No, I mean, I want to ask you for your advice. I know you've given us a lot already, but I think, you know, the last thing I just want to say about you and what you've shared is I'm looking forward to if and when you come back, like what that will look like for you and how that will just how that will impact your journey and how you approach it. So I'll definitely be following along. And I think just everything you shared has been so beneficial. So if you could leave us with your best advice for the girl who has never competed before, but is thinking about it, and then your best advice mm-hmm. for someone on their road to pro.
All right. So for the girl who's never competed before and is thinking about it, I would definitely say, first, focus on lifestyle habits before you just jump right into a show. Be in a good place, like mindset-wise and lifestyle habit-wise. I feel like it's important for people to really make changes, behavioral changes first before training, dieting into, I want to get ready for this show. I think if you really take that approach, you're setting yourself up for success more so. I mean, because to be fair, yeah, you could just like, I want to do a show. I'm just going to like all in, let's do it. And then crash diet and crash train and like, you know, try and jump on that stage because you, whatever, if it's a bucket list or, you know, you just want to try it. It's really like that's hard on someone's body. It's hard on your mentality. And if you really, if you doing a show is inspiring you to better yourself, then better yourself in a way that you can maintain for your life and your livelihood moving forward. Don't make this a one-stop shop. Make this a way to motivate you to transcend beyond just that one show. That would be my best advice, you know, for never competed before. For someone who is on your road to pro, I honestly would say, find a trainer or a coach that can help you, or some type of support that can help you, and works with you in the way that you feel comfortable and you feel good about. Because you really want to understand that, you know, obviously, like I earned my pro card within my first year, which was not very common at that time when I started competing. And some girls, they do. Some girls win it in their first, you know, wow, they did one amateur show and then they got their pro card at their next show. Like some girls do. And some girls, they've been competing for years and years and years and years. And finally at, you know, year 5 or 6 or 7, whatever it is, they just get their pro card. Everyone's journey is different. So be prepared for the sacrifices you need to make that happen. Wherever there's a will, there is a way. So if you really want that, and if that is your priority, then stick with it. Just do it in the right way and have the right team of people to support you in obtaining that goal, and enjoy the journey there. And I say that again, enjoy the journey there. Mm-hmm. I know it's very hard when it's for those who have done it a couple of times and they still haven't got it and they just, you know, keep trying. It's hard to enjoy that journey, but there's something that you just need to learn still. That's really what it comes down to. There's just something you need to learn. You'll get there. If you want it and you're passionate about it and you keep trying, you will get there. And I guess like really that's just kind of all I could say. I think mine just flew by so fast and I was enjoying it, but I didn't really even absorb it. Like obviously I went into my pro shows just kind of like bang, 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 like next show, next show, next show. So I almost wish I would have taken a step back a little bit and just like let it all sink in a little bit more because it just happened so fast. But you know, just appreciate the process and learn from every single opportunity. That's my best advice.
Beautiful advice. Wow. Thank you for that. I am grateful for your time and for your energy and for the way that you showed up today. And I want other people to be able to tag you as they listen or reach out to you with follow-ups or let you know what resonated with them. So can you let us know where people can connect with you or maybe even work with you too?
Yeah, absolutely. I think the best would be Instagram. It's just at Francesca Loren. I do have a Facebook page as well. I think it's Francesca Loren IFBB Pro, and my YouTube channel, which I did say I'm going to try and be more active on. I do have a few videos up there, but it's I think it's just Francesca Loren IFBB Pro as well. So those would probably be the best options. And I think my email's on one of those.
Perfect. I will put all of those links in the show notes page, which you guys can always find on celestial.fit/podcast. If you're listening right away, Francesca's episode is going to be all the way at the top. If you're listening in the future, just scroll to the category section and it's alphabetized. So you'll be able to find her there. And you guys can access all the show notes, episode timestamps, the links that she just gave to us, and then other resources as well. So really grateful for you guys listening. And Francesca, I'm super grateful for you coming on.
Absolutely. Thank you so much for having me. It's an absolute honor to be on your podcast. So,
oh my gosh, it's my honor.
But thank also you. For your time and your questions as well. So thank
you. Of course. Celeste. Absolutely. Well, I hope you all have an amazing rest of your day, night, or morning, wherever you are in the world, where you're listening to this episode.